Lever systems in the human body. A lever is one of the simplest machines known. Basically, it consists of two forces, an effort force and resisting force acting around a pivot or a fulcrum. The distance from the effort force to the fulcrum is the force arm, and the distance from the resisting force to the fulcrum is the resistance arm. At equilibrium, the product of the force times the force arm is equal to the product of resistance times the resistance arm. It should be emphasized that the force and the resistance refer only to the rotary components of the actual forces, that's to say, the components that are directed at 90 degrees to the lever arm. The mechanical advantage the machine provides is determined by dividing the force arm distance by the resistance arm distance. That's to say, the mechanical advantage of a lever depends on where the forces are located. Regarding the uses of levers, there are three main uses of levers. First, change the direction of effort force. And this is what's going to be seen in first class levers. Second, increase the force. And that's what's going to be seen in second class levers. And third, as we are going to see in third class levers, there is gain of distance. So levers are of three classes: first class, second class, and third class, and each class serves a specific function. In first class levers, they have the pivot or the fulcrum located between the effort and resistance. Its mechanical advantage can be greater or less than one. So here we can see that the mechanical advantage is more than one, where the pivot is closely related or is at a short distance from the resistance. That's why the resistance arm is shorter than the effort arm. However, the mechanical advantage can be less than one, as in this kind of lever, where the mechanical advantage is less than one because the resistance arm is longer than the effort arm or the force arm. The teeter-totter is a good example of this class of lever, and as we have said earlier, that first class lever, they change the direction of the effort force. As an anatomical example of this kind of lever, first class lever, is the action of the splenius muscle. The splenius muscle acting to extend the head across the atlanto-occipital joint. In fact, it's not only the splenius muscle, but the muscles at the back of the neck, while they act to balance the head across the atlanto-occipital joint, they act as on a first class lever. In the second class levers, the resistance is located between the effort and the fulcrum. An example of second class lever is the wheelbarrow. Since the resistance arm is always less than the force arm, therefore the mechanical advantage is always greater than one. However, in this arrangement, the effort must always move a greater distance than the resistance. That's to say, the range of motion is sacrificed to gain force. And this is the main function of this kind of lever. That's to gain force. This type of levers is rare in the body, and the fact that muscle insertions are so frequently found close to the joints they move precludes many muscles from acting in a lever system of the second class. However, plantar flexion of the foot at the ankle joint is an example. Here, the pivot is at the metatarsophalangeal joints. The resistance is the line of gravity, while the force is the pull of the triceps suri muscle on the calcaneus. Again, I repeat that in this arrangement, the effort must always move a greater distance than the resistance. That's to say, the range of motion is sacrificed to gain force. And this is what we need here. Here we need to gain force in order to overcome the body weight. In the third class of levers, they have the effort located between the fulcrum and the resistance. A common example is found in a hammer pulling out a nail. Here, exerting a lot of force to pull the handle a little results in a larger movement of the nail. In this situation, the effort arm is always less than the resistance arm. To support resistance, effort must be of greater magnitude than the resistance, but the effort moves less distance than the resistance. Hence, in third class levers, there is loss in effort but gain in distance. This class of levers is one of the most common in the body, since it permits muscles to produce distance of movement with minimal muscle shortening, although at sacrifice of force. A typical example is found in the biceps when the forearm is flexed. Again, I repeat that third class levers are the most common levers in the body. This is supported by the fact that muscle insertions are so frequently found close to the joints they move. Therefore, the effort is located between the pivot and the resistance, creating a third class lever. Because the levers of the human body are adapted for range, speed, and precision of movement rather than for handling weight, it's not surprising that the incidence of injuries attributed to lifting is high.